Alrighty, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, the moment you've all been waiting for! Just kidding, it's just Batman vs. Superman.
Warning, you are now entering the madhouse, where butt sex, cursing, racial comments, and sexual content are normal. If you are prepared for the insanity, enjoy, and don't forget to subscribe for more horror fuckery.
Welcome to the place where you're in the camera, and I'm just gonna be something great, and today we are here, as you can tell by the name of the goddamn fucking video, to discuss Batman vs. Superman's impact on the DC Extended Universe, or the DC Cinematic Universe, depending on how you look at it. I'm gonna start off by saying that this is not a terrible movie, but it is a terrible movie. Okay, and it's a great concept and in theory, and it's what they went for is kind of is admirable, but admirable. I mean, but it fails in so many areas, and I'm gonna do my best to explain those things today. And you might be asking, well, what does that have to do with the impact on the DC cinematic universe? We can't call the DC, what would it be, DCCU, because that doesn't work. So they do DCEU, and then Marvel has MCU. I don't know, it's so stupid. But anyway, we're going to compare the two universes slightly. So there's going to be a lot of comparisons to Marvel in this. That's just because Marvel has the best example of an extended universe into the cinematic world. And they do a great job of connecting all their movies together as a single entity. Now, DC is trying to go for the same thing. And Batman vs. Superman was supposed to be the thing that sparked that extended universe. But it was executed very poorly and hated pretty much universally. Several problems here, and we're gonna discuss them right now. But like I said, what does that have to do with the impact on the DCU? Well, you have to understand the movie as a whole to be able to say what the impact on the entire universe is and what it means for the future of the movies. So we're gonna start off with number one. Number one is the darkness factor. What is the darkness factor, you may ask? Now, let me explain it to you. Probably there needs to be context, okay? The DC universe is well known for dark story tones in the backstories as well as the main stories of some of the characters. Now, that's all fine and dandy. Most of the characters have messed up backgrounds. Excuse me. Most of the characters in comic book stories that are villains have messed up backgrounds, but in DC's case, most of the heroes have messed up backgrounds. And that's not to take away from the MCU at all, or, well, the Marvel comic book universe. There are very dark story tones, but for the most part, Marvel is a very light, upbeat thing. Now, that's not to say DC's always been like this. DC is like the pinnacle of the darkness in some characters, like Batman being the gold standard in the modern day. The Golden Age stuff and the origins of comic books were very different. They're very much more campy themed and a very light and very for kids. And that's to fit the times and to fit what comic books were back then. And then we delve into the future and then get these dark story tones and these fun. For me, it's fun. I love darkness and gore and horror and stuff like that. It's just fun. It makes sense. But that's enough babbling about comic books. What does this all have to do with Batman vs. Superman? Glad you asked, asshole. Now, the MCU, like I said, is very campy in their movies still to this day, and it's meant for kids. They got PG-13 ratings, and although there are some adult-themed story tones, it's not like a full-on experience. It's not, you're not going to go to an Avengers movie and expect to have a very dark story tone. There's going to be pieces of it, but it's going to be very light. There's going to be a lot of jokes. There's going to be real, even the movie, the way it's shot and everything is very light. And that makes a big difference. Now, DC movies in the past, like Batman Begins and so on and so forth, are very story-oriented with a darker tone to the movie and a more realistic, gritty feeling when you go and watch those movies, right? Now, that works for some characters, but not all of them. And that has to do with why Batman vs. Superman couldn't get it right. Batman, like I said, he's the gold standard for the very dark storylines. And most of the darker storylines in DC have to do with Batman. Don't get me wrong, there are plenty of others that are way worse. But Batman, like, is the gold standard when it comes to your top picks for heroes. Like, he's one of the most well-known and most popular heroes of all time, period. And, I mean, come on, I'm a huge fan of him myself. But sometimes, you know, he has the darker story tone. Sometimes he doesn't. But this is not a Batman movie. It's got three main characters. It's got Batman, Superman, and Wonder Woman. These are three very different heroes aesthetically and story-wise. So, how does all this relate to each other? Batman is a darker character. Darkness works for him. Dark storylines work for him. But not all characters are dark. Wonder Woman and Superman are polar opposites in regard to Batman. They're not the most... They don't have... Not to say that they don't have dark backstories and dark stories in general. But they're more well known for being very campy, very children-oriented. They're happier. They don't curse. They don't kill sometimes. You know, it's a very different feeling. Don't misconstrue me. There are dark storylines in their backstories and other storylines. There's plenty out there. But that's not the heroes we're used to. Those are very off-putting, and it's very different. Now, people are going to talk Man of Steel, of course. Out there, it had a darker tone. So your theory's wrong, is what people are going to tell me in the comments. No shit! Shut up! Now, there's... Man of Steel did a great job balancing the dark story tones with a lighter character. So there is moments of lightness and moments of darkness, and then it kind of melded them together to make this cohesive relationship that it's not necessarily a very dark story, but it is a more seriously toned story, and that's all fine and dandy. Batman versus Superman just went, they tried being very dark toned movie, but they also tiptoed around a lot of things that they should have just gone for. Now, there's this great scene that was taken out of the script that would have helped with the aspect of darkness, and it had to do with Clark Kent. Let's see. The scene was Superman listening for a certain crime or a certain person, and he's using his super hearing, and he's hearing the entire city, and not just Gotham, he's also hearing Metropolis, and he's hearing all this death and destruction and all these problems that he cannot fix, and he's just in this very dark place. And it's very overwhelming. You hear screaming, you hear murder, you hear people dying, you hear crimes happening, you hear all these people, and he realizes it very down deep in his core that he can't do nothing about that. No matter how many people he saves, he's never going to be able to save everybody, and he can't fix the world being what it is. And that, so he himself kind of limits his hearing, so he doesn't hear all that at all times. So that's why he couldn't just go look for his mother, because he can't decipher one noise out of all of these various tragedies going on without having major backlash on his mental state and on himself. Now, that's a very awesome scene. It would have been great. It's a very dark view, right? It would have made Superman feel a little better. But they didn't include it. And they're stupid for not doing that. In order for a dark theme to work, there needs to be two things: a solid story and moments of levity to break the darkness and make it distinguishable. And it has to be done properly. Look at... So I'm going to say one movie that does it perfectly. Logan. Logan is an R-rated movie. It has a very dark story. It has a very real story. It's very bloody. It's very violent. It's beautifully done. It was written perfectly. They didn't go for a ridiculous amount of over-the-top stuff. And it was incredible what they did with that movie. They did a phenomenal job with the dark tones and they didn't pussyfoot around anything. They really went for it, and it worked. You got to just kind of, if you're going to go with a dark movie, you just got to go all in, and you have to have a solid story. And it can't just be, it can be darkness, 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 but there has to be those moments in there where you kind of, you break from not only for a little bit of kind of morbid comedy, I like to call it, but also for the fact that you need to break the major plot points between, and so you have time to process what happened and then go on to the next major plot point. You see what I mean? Batman vs. Superman did a terrible job of doing that. They just kind of rolled through everything quickly and they steamrolled it and they did horrible. Now, we have Superman and Wonder Woman. Two very lighthearted characters that exist in a darker toned story. That's all fine and dandy, but they needed to make them in that story. And it just didn't work for them. It does work to have darker characters and lighter characters come together, but there has to be a happy medium there. And Batman vs. Superman couldn't find that, and they couldn't justify doing it, and it just didn't work. DC is a more multifaceted universe in general. That's great, but it also brings this balancing act that has to be taken on with care. Batman vs. Superman did the opposite of that. One big reason why it failed. That is one big reason why it failed. Excuse my broken English. But, you know, it could have been better. And this isn't the only reason there. Okay, if you're going to go for darker tone Superman and Wonder Woman, then put them in that situation. Don't leave things out. Go all in on that. Don't just, oh yeah, we're going to do it like this. No, that's stupid. You're a fucking idiot. Go fuck yourself. And it just doesn't work. There has to be a balance for it to work, especially when there's this many characters involved and this much story, overarching stories in one. Then you have to have it perfect, and they just didn't do that. They didn't put enough work into it. They didn't put enough passion, and not to discredit them, but it's just it was done poorly. Now, on to my second point. Number two, not to the fans. Now, we all know Marvel's connects all their movies through Easter eggs to prove a continuous storyline across multiple movies. It also gives nods to the comic book fans as well at all times, but they're very minor and they're just kind of tucked in the background. Sometimes they're major plot points, but if they are, they're very well explained and they do a great job of going into that. Batman vs. Superman tried and failed in some aspects and thrived in others. There are little nods here and there, but let's talk about the major ones that they actually tried to include as major plot points, and that didn't work. Batflack, aka Ben Affleck as Batman, Vision, we see in his visions, we see nods to Apocalypse with his soldiers and his symbol on the ground and all of that good stuff. And that's all cool. And then we see the Flash coming to Batflack, and Batflack wakes up. And that's a nod to the Flashpoint Paradox in the comic books. Or at least that's what I think it is. I don't exactly know what it is. They haven't said what it is, but I have a feeling that's what it's going to be. And that's how they can, I have a theory about how that can fix the universe, but that's for another video entirely. And, I just want to point out one small detail that they did a great job of showing. So to prove that the Flash was not just a vision, you can see the papers in the background falling and floating down as the Flash is gone and Bruce is trying to figure out what the fuck just happened. And it's just to show that he was really in the room and he wasn't fucking crazy and it wasn't a vision. So that is a cool thing. Now, we also have the Robin suit as an ode to the comic book A Death in the Family, one of the best comic book stories ever, one of the darkest comic book story ever, in which Jason Todd, aka Robin, is captured by the Joker and beat ruthlessly with a crowbar in front of his mother, and then left for dead with him and his mother in front of a bomb. In an attempt to save his mother's life, Robin jumps on top of the bomb and ultimately perishes. His mother only manages to live long enough for Batman to come. And she tells him what happened, and she dies in Batman's arm, and then Batman walks off with Robin's dead body. Wow! What an awesome movie that would be, am I right? And that's what that Robin suit means. Now, it is no subtle Easter egg, and I would love to see that done in any movie fashion, whatever. It's been done in TV shows before, but on the big screen, I would love to see it. Just like I would love to see a Killing Joke on the screen. That would be amazing. And yes, that happened, and it's wonderful and dark, and if you haven't read the comic before, go read it, because it's awesome. Now, these were major plot points. That's fine if there's pre-existing story cinematically, or an or at least some sort, even if it's very brief, explanation as to why these things are happening or why these things are there in the story. And that's where it failed, because then you have all these things happening and then it's like they don't explain it well enough and then they become plot holes. And when there's plot holes, the plot itself begins to deteriorate and fall apart. And that was a major, major flaw with Batman vs. Superman. Now, it's fine and a cool nod to the comics and the movies, but the movies would have been a lot better without them. And it just caused more questions than answers, and it caused the movie as a whole to suffer, and that sucks. Now, for the next point. Number 3. Too much backstory. This is a big one for me. Now, raise your hand here if you're tired of seeing origin stories nowadays in superhero movies, because I know I sure am, especially Batman and Spider-Man. I'm so fucking done with that. It's stupid. We gotta watch Tom Holland on the new Spider-Man do another goddamn origin story, and I just want to blow my goddamn brains out. I'm sure they're gonna do it again for the new Batfleck movie. It's gonna be stupid and it's overdone, and we all fucking know what's going on. Now, back to a point I made earlier, there were 3 major characters in this movie. I understand that. But there was so much Batman, and there was so much Batman backstory. Now, Batflack is arguably the greatest part about this movie for me. He's an awesome actor. He does a great job playing Batman. He has the potential to be my favorite Batman ever. Right now, he's amazing. And he's awesome, and he does it well. But we didn't need to see his damn origin story again. Especially in this movie, this wasn't about Batman. It wasn't about Superman. It was about them coming to a conclusion where they have to do battle. And that's the whole point, and that's what the movie was marketed for. Not a Batman origin story, and not to hear Wonder Woman's backstory, which there's a whole movie for her already, and Batman's going to have his own damn movie now too. So what the fuck is the point, damn it? And, okay, I get we're going to get origin stories. I get it. But this was unneeded. Batman is an established character in the DC universe already. We didn't need to see that. They could have done the origin story in the Batman movie. They could have released the Batman movie before, so we have that backstory. But they didn't. And that's a failure. You could have taken all of the backstory out for Batman, most of it. And we would have been fine, and used it to do so many other stuff, so much other stuff. What is that even fucking English? What the fuck am I saying right now? God damn it! Anyway, now for my next point. Number 4, crappy plot. Now, this isn't all entirely a terrible plot. Just the latter half of the movie was. I could have done without Darkseid. That could have been saved for a later movie. It could have been saved for a Superman movie. He's a more Superman-oriented character, and there's so many great storylines that they could have gone with for it. And they blew it on this stupid movie. And there's also, I just want to say, the story where Batman and Superman were manipulated into hating and inevitably fighting each other, that was great. That's what the movie was advertised as. But we got none of the fighting. I mean, what was there, like 10 minutes? I don't even think that much of Batman and Superman fighting. I want to see them, like, all out 30-minute brawl. And they're both, like, exhausted in the end. And just, I don't know. Fuck. That's what I went to see. Or at least focus a little more on the plot. Please? Can we get a redo? We need to build a fucking time machine yet so I can go fix this shit. And no Batman origin story. Definitely no Batman origin story. Now, I would have liked to have seen a lot more. You know? They were great up until the point where they stop fighting and the dark side comes and then everything just gets convoluted and stupid and it's like, bleh. Stop it. Now, Lex manipulation powers are great. Now, this is the story I want to go. This is the story I would go for. This is the plot in my head that I wanted to see and that I would love to see in a movie in the future if they're going to redo this. Lex manipulation powers stays the same. Batman and Superman duke it out and go all out on each other. Crazy over the top fight scene. They both realize they've been toyed with. They go to confront Lex together. Lex has a power suit and has both characters on the ropes. Wonder Woman busts in and saves both of them. All three of them work together to defeat Lex Luthor. Now that sounds like a better movie, doesn't it? Everything from the beginning can stay the same pretty much. Except for the Batflex stuff. Like, take his backstory out and all most of the visions and all that stuff, and then just go with it. Lex kick some ass, get his ass kicked, you know, stuff like that. Wouldn't that be a great movie? I will say this one thing, though. Wonder Woman's entrance during the fight is my favorite scene in the movie. Let me put it this way, to show how awesome this scene was. For fans and everybody. So I went to the Batman vs. Superman world premiere night thing that they had in the city down the road from me. Which, by down the road, I mean like an hour and a half away. But anyway. So I went. They had this big theater. It was IMAX theater. I bought tickets, you know, weeks before. Me and my family went. There was cosplayers and stuff. And it was just cool. So we go in the theater and, you know, it's packed. Sold out. And everybody's like on the ropes on whether they like it or not. Most people kind of liked it at first, and then they go in, then they go home and digest it. And they're like, God damn, that was a fucking terrible movie. Like, when I first watched it, I was like, cool, this is a great movie. And then I went home and was like, oh, this is fucking terrible. And then I started looking into it a little more, and I'm like, it's okay. And then I'm making this video, so obviously it's not complete fucking failure in my eyes, but it is a stepping stone. We'll put it that way. But anyway. The scene when Wonder Woman comes out, she's blocking with the shield and the music comes on. Literally the entire, everybody who was there, and I think it was like a 500 people auditorium or something, or more than that probably. Everybody erupted into applause when that music came on and Wonder Woman came out. We all see who she is. And then that one joke in the movie that I liked. She with you? I thought she was with you. You know, and it's like, it's so funny. And I'm just like, okay, y'all win. You know, that's like the one scene that I wouldn't want to take out, and they would have to be done in a different way, but it was great. It's a great scene, and I love that. Now, for my next point, and it's not really a point until you get it with context, and that is number 5, Martha. This is arguably the most talked about scene and the dumbest scene in the movie. Batflack is about to kill Superman. Superman says, save Martha, his mother, who we know Lex has taken as a hostage. Bruce is taken back, starts screaming, why you say that name? And Lois comes in and explains that it is his mother. Bruce takes a step back, off now, and he throws the kryptonite spear he was about to kill Superman with. Why was he about to kill? Oh, fucking, there's so much. This is a convoluted storyline. I could stay here talking 3 fucking hours about the goddamn movie, and I would never finish talking about everything I want to talk about. But, so, even explaining it now, you know, you got to kind of chuckle. Like, this sounds fucking stupid. That their mothers had the same name, so they teamed up instead of killing it. What? Yeah, it's stupid. It seems stupid, right? It's actually not. If we look at it with some context added, we can get it right. Let me explain what I'm talking about. Now, look at the way Batflack is his mind is warped throughout the movie to view Superman as one thing. Now, in fact, let's go to the beginning of the movie. Beginning scenes of the movie. Bruce heading into the chaos. He's viewing the fight from street level, which, by the way, let me just say another thing. Beautiful scene. Cinematography was great. One of the better portions of the movie is this in itself. It shows what it would be like to be me or you on the streets viewing this insane fight up in the sky. All the chaos and the death and destruction around everybody. And it does a great job to show how small and powerless humans would feel in that situation. And it's awesome. Now, that's cool. And you get this awesome scene of the panning out where Bruce saved the little girl. And we get the Wayne logo and everything. And Bruce is looking up. And all he sees is these two entities fighting that he can't even comprehend their power at this moment, and he doesn't know what they are, and that's all well and dandy. So he's trying to figure it out, and he doesn't know if Superman's gonna be a threat or not. Nah, 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 nah. And then we look at the media's influence on all of this, and the people in general of Earth. The media and the people view Superman as godlike, as a deity. They put him on this high pedestal and view him as their savior, their god, their belief system, whatever the case may be. Now, historically, this is backed as the natives viewed the Spanish explorers like that when they first came in the 1400s over to the Americas, which makes sense. Very technologically advanced. They don't know who these people are. Of course, they're going to worship them like gods because they don't understand what they are seeing. So, you now know that the world looks at Superman as God, as a God-like being. Okay. Bruce views Superman as a deity as well, as all-powerful. But in his mind, he sees what could happen. What if Superman is bad? What if he decides to destroy the planet? What if he decides to take over the world? Who knows? Instead of saving it. Then we have a very powerful thought in his head. This deity, this thing, needs to be stopped before it has the opportunity to become bad. Because in Batflack's experiences from when he became Batman to now, it's very obvious that he's a very torn person, and he does not really have his morals all in order. So in his mind, he just assumes that this person's going to be bad. He's seen it happen over and over again. He's seen it happen with Harvey Dent. He's seen it happen with others, and it's just one of those things. So he's just assuming that Superman's going to be bad, so he needs to find a way to stop him. Okay? So, that's how he views Superman. As bad. So he, in his head, he needs to stop him, right? He views him as an alien, nothing more than a deity who has no way of possibly understanding humans and will eventually think they're dangerous and needs to be stopped. He does, you know, that's how Batman views him. Now back to the Martha scene. When Bruce hears the name, all of his thinking crumbles. You might be asking why. Not only do these two characters have the same mother's names, that doesn't have anything to do with it until the ending, okay? Superman is showing empathy for another being in this instance. Bruce never thought that Superman could do that, right? He didn't think it was possible. And then seeing Lois come in and seeing how much they care for each other and seeing how much they're worried about Superman's mother, he looks at Superman for the first time as a human. As a man who has people he cares about that he just like Bruce. He wants to protect them, and he wants to save people. All of that nonsense and doubt in Bruce's head and all that anger towards this person all fades away. And it's just, he sees clearly for the first time in the movie. And he's awakened. He's like, whoa, this isn't just a deity who doesn't understand us. He's a man just like I am, who's just trying to protect the people he loves. Shit. What the fuck have I been doing this whole time? Now go back and watch that scene with everything I just said and tell me it's still stupid. Seriously. That was very well done. And it makes you see and appreciate what the crew of this movie was going for overall with the movie. And it gives me hope for the future of the DCEU. Because if they use complicated plots and things like that, where you really have to take a step back and overanalyze things to really understand what's going on, that's a movie I'll go see every time. It's a great idea. They did this one scene that everybody hails the dumbest scene in the whole movie, for me is the best one. Because of what it stands for. And because if you look at all the facts and you actually put your brain into something other than fucking Facebook for 10 seconds, you'll understand what's going on. And that is beautiful. Now, for my final point, number 6, too much too soon. Now, while I don't completely hate this movie, I'm not gonna lie, I've seen it quite a few times now. I've seen the extended version, and the extended version is the superior movie, by the way. It is a little bit better, it's a little more withstandable, and it's just overall great. I don't love it, but it has its moments. But those moments are separated by filler and nonsense, and we didn't really need it to be there. Now, the core problem here was the crew bit off more than they could chew. They wanted to put so much into this project and appease everyone, comic book lovers, the movie lovers, you know, just, you know, Batman fan, Superman fan, Wonder Woman fan. It just didn't work. They did too much in this movie. This movie could have been very easily broken into 2 or 3 movies, and it would have been great. They could have gone more in depth of why Batman's having those visions and what they mean. They could have gone more in depth of Clark's, you know, struggling with this status that the people have put him on, and, you know, and his mortality and all this. And then we could have gone into depth in Wonder Woman too. And it's like, we could have delved more into why Batman hates Superman, and it could have been great. That's not what we got to see. Now, they tried shoving all these Easter eggs and plot twists and origin stories and conflicts into one movie. It is just too much. I went to see a great Batman and Superman fight it out for the first time on the big screen because we've read it in the comics, and I wanted to see that. It's been my dream since I was a child to see that on the big screen, and I would have loved to have seen it. We got that kind of with a whole bunch of extra bullshit. Now, I don't blame the crew for all of this. Studio added and cut a lot of things that made it even more complicated and convoluted. And that makes a huge difference. And I said this before, it's not a terrible movie. I've said it like 10 times. It's just so much to digest at one time. And there has to be breaks between major plot points, otherwise they're all blurred together and it makes a terrible movie, unless it's done properly. I mean, we can't all be Inception, where it's just a completely complicated plot and it's just absolutely insane, and you gotta watch it 4, 5, 10, 20 times, and then you can finally take a step back and say, oh, that's what it is. This is amazing. And Inception is on my top 5 movies of all time. It's an incredible movie. It was done very proper. Now, this was a cinematic juggernaut of a project, and the crew just couldn't pull it off. in a justifiable way. And that's too bad. But now we get to the whole point of this video. What does it mean for the DC Extended Universe? What does it mean for the future? Well, it's the beginning of a new and exciting universe full of diversity, dark and light story tones, and amazing characters. It may have failed in the box offices and in the fans' eyes, but it set up an entire movie universe. Now we don't have to look towards the future with uncertainty. We need to look at it with hope and dedication and learn from the mistakes of the past, right? And use the things that did work in this movie as a blueprint and as a starting point for future projects. We just might have a truly comic book inspired cinematic universe. All comic book fans, not just DC or Marvel, not just Batman or Superman, but all comic book fans can be proud of. This movie was a step in a direction, and I do believe it is the right one. And it is the blueprint for what not to do in a superhero movie. Suicide Squad is a major leap in the direction we want it to go. But that's another topic for another video, and I'm not going to get into that at all, because that's a spoiler for a future video coming up. Now, I have a feeling Wonder Woman will be the same way. Another giant leap in the forward. From what I've seen so far of Wonder Woman and what I've heard about the plot, it's going to be an incredible movie, and it's everything we wanted from the original Captain America movie and so much more. And I love fucking Wonder Woman, man. I'm so glad. Linda Carter will always be Wonder Woman to me, though. Just saying. Just like... Okay, we're not going to get into that, actually. We'll talk about that in a different video. But that's two different topics for two different videos, like I said. Don't forget to check those out. But I hope you're as excited for the DC Extended Universe as I am. I want to see more. I want to see more Batman. I want to see more Superman. I want to see more Wonder Woman. I want to see more of this universe. I want to see more dark story tones come in, and I want to see more light story tones come in, and then I want to see a movie where all of them meld together and they work perfectly better than the Avengers, because to be honest, Marvel's great. Don't get me wrong. I love Marvel. But DC is my bag because of they have a tendency to have darker stories. Like, the Joker is my favorite comic book character, period. Because you don't know what his origin story is. He doesn't know what his own origin story is. That's the greatest part about it. He says what is the story? The Killing Joke. Sometimes I see it this way, sometimes I see it another, sometimes completely different. I don't even know what my own origin is anymore. I don't even know if it's true anymore. You know, he's talking about his backstory, and it's like, okay, I can respect that. That's cool. He's always a very dark character. He's very well done. And Batman's the same way. I'm not the biggest fan of Superman. I wasn't the biggest fan of Superman, I should say. And then I started reading some of his darker storylines and stuff, and I started reading some of the newer comic books, and I actually really enjoy him, and it's really good. Any of the new 52 stuff is amazing, but there's so much great stories to pull from in the DC universe. And the cool thing about DC, it's so much simpler for Marvel, because Marvel has their main line of continuity in the comics, and they have all these side stories that aren't canon. With DC, every comic book is canon. Which, what? Yeah, every comic book is canon because they've delved into the multiverse theories and stuff. And that's another theory that I need to make in a video. The multiverse theory thing? Oh, God. There could be so many good movie plots out of that. Like, I have this whole story in my head of how the Batman movie should go and could fix this DC universe and also bring in pieces of the other universes and the older movies. That would be awesome and far above anything that has ever been done in a movie universe. But that's enough talking about that. Tell me what y'all think down below. Let's talk about it. Don't forget to check out my Twitter and Instagram if you really want to get into detailed conversations. Hit me up there. That's the easiest way to get a hold of me, because I'm always on it. YouTube might take me a day or two to get back to you. Now, I hope you enjoyed that breakdown of Batman vs. Superman. Let's hope for a better tomorrow. And let's hold these studios accountable, man. You know, they just because they're making money doesn't mean they should do it. They need to do justice by the fans. And this movie's a great example of not doing justice to the fans. And it's I'm so disappointed in it, man. For what it was, it could have been great, and it wasn't. And I'm so sad. But don't forget to check out my review on Logan. Great movie. Great movie. Great review. Go ahead and check that out. If you're into games and stuff, I play games on my channel as well. Be sure to subscribe if you're new. That's going to do it for this episode, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, make sure to leave a like. If you're new to the channel, new to the series, make sure to subscribe down below. I'll see y'all in the next video, whatever I make. Ta-ta for now. Now I'm out. Poof!